meeting, everyone. Today's date is Tuesday, November 15th, 2016, and I hereby call this meeting of the Bedford School Committee to order. To do so, we will begin with a roll call vote. Ms. Santiago.
Present.
Ms. Gray.
Present.
All right, present. That is enough. It's just three of us, but that's enough. Tracy, good to have you here today.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming. The first item on the agenda, as we do every meeting, is to open our discussion to comments from the public. So do we have a public vote in the comment? Looks like none. In that case, the next item on our agenda is the personnel report. Just a heads up, we're going to go a little bit out of order. We're going to go personnel report, then we'll do the IGU's presentation, and then we'll go back to the budget, please. So we'll get you along. All right, so personnel report.
Sure, so major personnel report, the outcomes are some appointments which are stipends, which I usually just give to Nancy. We don't have to go through them. So that really is it. You did ask for a list of field trips, going forward, and I think the significant ones are the ones in 17 and 18 at this point. So we have a trip planned for June to July to Ireland and the British Isles, the regular DC trip for the 8th grade, a trip for our science focus kids to the Galapagos in February of 2017, Barcelona and Andalusia in July of 2018, Panama City in April of 2018, and the Dominican Republic, a little out of order, in February of 2018. So those are the ones that are being considered. They're not all finalized, and my understanding is school committee asked that we're being thoughtful about coordinating so that kids know what's coming up so they can make choices if they're capable of making a choice. And of course, we know that not everybody can afford these trips, and that's the other concern, that we're being as proactive as possible around fundraising and providing scholarships where we can. So those are the ones on the docket.
Fantastic. All right, thank you for that. Up next is our art and music presentation. Welcome, thanks for being here tonight.
Thank you.
Nicole O'Toole, Sean Wright, our program administrators, directors, actually, KUB-12. Very excited that we hear what you have to share.
Thank you. And thank you for inviting Nicole and I here tonight. We have a stellar presentation for you. We will look down from 500 slides to 30, so in the presence of time,
we'll save you a little bit of time.
Maureen, well, we'll ask Tracy to fill us in with some anything we leave out. Thank you. So again, thank you for inviting us to talk a little bit about some of the exciting things that our music, theater, and visual art staff and students are working on K through 12 in the district. We've entitled this presentation Connections and Directions Across the Curricula. And we're going to share with you the current directions of each of our respective curricula, and as well as the connections we're making in each of our disciplines and the way it's related to the goals of the district.
So we have somewhat of a shared mission statement for both of our departments. The Bedford Public School Music, Theater Arts, and Visual Arts programs exist to foster cooperation, imagination, confidence, discipline, and self-motivation in students through creating, performing, connecting with, and evaluating the arts, so that all students fully realize their individual potential and become lifelong patrons of the arts in a global community.
So as I mentioned before, this is not really a comprehensive overview, but this is a little snapshot to sort of share with you some of the exciting things that we're excited about. So some of the curricular areas we're going to be touching on are cultural proficiency, cross-curricular connections, student self-reflection, and sense of community in each of the schools.
We reached out to some of our oldest students in each building and to share with you what they feel is important to them or special to them about music and art in their lives.
Okay. So I did get some interesting looks from some teachers as I was filming this. It was casual Friday, so I had a hooded sweatshirt on. I did have my badge. But crack security team at Davis, they got me before I left the building. Do you have permission? Yes. Okay. Next one. Do you want to get the next one?
Sure.
Didn't go for me. To go down.
Oh,
we have to go.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Let's make this one.
Oh, that's you. Sorry.
So as you most likely know, the Davis school community has all school assemblies throughout the year, and our music teacher and our school psychologist work together to bring the students together around themes such as getting to know you, celebrating our differences, friendship, and perseverance. So they work on music and other aspects of discussion in classes leading up to this, so all the students can gain a greater understanding of these themes within their lives. And we're just going to show you a little snippet of what it sounds like when 600 plus K1 and 2 sing together. Personally, I don't think it gets much better than that. It's awesome. And additionally, in addition to their all-school assemblies, they have spring concerts, which are typically focused around a children's book as a theme. And the students work together with the music teacher. They learn songs that are inspired towards their theme for the concert. And the art teacher additionally helps out with this by helping the students to create personalized props for the concert as well.
So at Davis, the idea of talking about artwork and the artwork of others is introduced, and it's really a cornerstone of the work that happens K through 12, which at the high school ends up as being a critique, what that entails. So at Davis, the idea of talking about artwork includes what it means to be respectful when someone is talking, such as active listening, and giving positive comments about each other's work. Another component that is used at Davis is the gallery walk. And what that is students walk quietly around the room looking at each other's work and observing and discussing what they saw. The work lays the foundation for building norms and vocabulary necessary to intelligently talk about and reflect on artwork.
In a similar fashion, our music students in their music classroom are having discussions about their behavior. It's an initiative of our music teacher this year to have these important discussions about how we're taking control of our own selves in a classroom situation as we learn new things, music, how we're interacting with each other, as we learn to play games and learn dances and learn to handle all the instruments. So she has words inspired by music: make good choices, use kind words, show respect, involve yourself, care for our room and our instruments. And they have discussions every so often about how they're doing as a class. And here's just a little bit of one of those discussions.
This is Mr. Smallbones' class, and we are reflecting on our behavior for today's class. Raise your hand if you think we made good choices today. Who can give me an example of something we did well or something that we could do better with regard to making good choices? Rebecca?
Okay,
so now Em. What about you? Using kind words or being kind to one another. Who can give me an example of a way we were kind or a way you thought we could do better? Noah.
We weren't being
mean. Great, so we got a point for you. Who can talk to us about the S, showing respect? Positive or negative, what could we say about it, Joseph?
And they go on to finish their discussion, but I think you can see that the students are really thinking about what they had done in class, reflecting upon their own behaviors and choices that they had made.
It's not working. Okay. So second grade students begin to do some self-assessment work, writing incomplete sentences, and that is sort of tied into ELA in their own classroom work. So the students are not only describing the process in which they created their artwork, but they're describing some of the elements that went into it as well. So the student wrote, "I used warm and cool colors," so they're learning about that, some of the elements and principles of design, "and I add three tails to it. I add a background to it." So this is a critical step that allows for deeper student understanding of the process about writing, and also supports the writing of the work that they're doing in the classrooms. The self-reflection is a common thread that really runs through K through 12 in the Bedford art experience.
Our Bedford community has a multicultural fair now for 2 years in a row, and last spring some of our youngest singers and some of our oldest singers took part together to sing a song together for the event. And we hope that our older students felt some sense of leadership as they were standing on stage with their second grade peers, their younger, some siblings and younger students. And we hope that all of the students felt a sense of community as they contributed to this important Bedford event. And since that event is on a weekend, we hope our students understand a bit about volunteering their time for a greater good as well. I think it's a great event.
So this slide represents some of the cultural proficiency work that goes into the art program at Davis. On the left, we have some cultural masks that are indicative of the work done in Africa and South America and also China or Asia. And on the right, we have some Chinese ink wells and brush rests, which are not really functional because when my son poured ink into his, it ran right out. But it's the thought that counts, right? So, and his is on the left. It's the rhino. I called it an elephant, and he said, "Nope, that's a rhino." So. But they're learning about some of the art throughout the world, and what they're also doing is not only that, but they're adding their own components to it and making it their own.
Our fifth grade students are getting older. Here are some examples from our Lane School.
And
I'm always struck by how much they've grown in just 3 years. So again, our students at the Lane School, these are some fifth grade projects. They're working together, understanding in a sort of a different way community by creating compositions together, making choices about collaboratively about what patterns they want to have, what instruments they're going to use, and then working together to bring those compositions to life. It takes quite a bit of coordination. So in the first example, you'll see that they have written their patterns on a board and they're reading off the board. So a lot of decision making going on there. And when we see our next group, they're doing body percussion. They've memorized their parts and they've made choices about what sounds they can, they've experimented with what sounds they can make on various parts of their bodies. They've created an entirely independent passage that they perform in unison first, then they play another second passage, which is completely different, using new sounds, and they actually do it in canon, like around one starting after the other. Then they go back and do their first pattern again. And this actually goes on to have three or four more independent sections from the other, but here we'll just see the first three.
Hi, I'm Daniel.
Hi, I'm Matt.
Hi, I'm John.
Hi, I'm Rob.
I think it's quite complicated, actually, and you have to give them credit for working hard to memorize that and to perform that well together.
Okay. So this slide represents some of the cultural proficiency work that our students at Lane do. They continue their exploration of cultural competency as well as self-identity. The projects below represent a handful of projects that address these themes. From the left, we have a student self-identity piece where the objective was to represent a meaningful imagery and mix representational skin tones. So student is interested in music, so we have some music notes above and some scales and the word music. The next piece is a collaborative Wampanoag village that is connected to the social studies curriculum. As students are learning about Native Americans in social studies, they are creating these three-dimensional models of Wampanoag and pilgrim settlements and learning how to spatially represent and build three-dimensional objects. The last item is a Japanese notan project. Notan literally translates to light and dark. And students create watercolor washes on top of which they make compositional choices and cut symmetrical and asymmetrical pieces and patterns out of one sheet of paper. So they're fairly complex. Each one of them has their own uniqueness about it.
It's our hope that we can raise some independent musicians here, and the way we start that is with our ensemble work at the elementary level. And our teacher here has been working with the chorus. She's talked to them about the proper shapes that you use, with the opening of your mouth and the feeling that you have when you sing various vowel sounds especially. And she asks the students, after they try the song again and to sing it tall, like she had explained to them, how that felt to them, if they could share their ideas with their classmates, and then she calls them together for a group discussion on that matter. So they're reflecting on their practice, they're working hard to consider what the teachers told them and put that into practice in their own bodies. So you can hear these students, even at a young age, using musical terms and reflecting upon what they've done and putting it all together and I don't know, thinking about how they're doing and how they can do it differently the next time.
Okay. So common to what is being done at Davis, we're talking about in the Lane Art Room what it means to be a student artist and all that that entails. So. We were talking about using materials and tools responsibly, trying your best, giving your best effort, thinking about your choices that you make as an artist, as a student, and being a good sharer, sharing your ideas with one another and also your tools and materials. Another thing that continues at Lane from Davis is the idea of gallery walks and continuing that thread so students can continue to observe and reflect on their artwork and the artwork of others.
Our eighth grade students, they're almost high schoolers. Here they are.
Hi, I'm Megan Lawson, and I'm in eighth grade. Art is important to me because it gives me a chance to express my creativity and it gives me a chance to teach in a different way than all my other academic classes. My name is Oliver Nogo. Art is important to me because, especially middle school, because in a time when it's so hard to communicate what you're feeling, art can allow you to express in new ways.
Hi, I'm Kim Miller, and music is special to me because I'm quite shy and it has helped me open up to others.
Okay.
Our sixth grade students are beginning their journey into understanding cultural proficiency. They are keeping song journals as they work throughout the year. The teachers are introducing them to a variety of songs from various parts of the world and various cultures and in various styles and time periods. And they are asked to, and although this I Feel Good by James Brown might not be from far away, but the students are asked to listen to it with new ears and new eyes and think about the instruments that they heard, maybe how what type of emotions the song brought up in them, and I'm sure the teacher shared some of the history around the song with the class as well. Another project that I'm excited about in the sixth grade is our Star Spangled Banner, and that helps the students, again, working towards some understanding of their own culture, and they learn about the history behind the Star Spangled Banner. They are comparing and contrasting it with anthems from around the world, and hopefully understanding some of the diversity that is brought to us, and perhaps some of their own culture, they might say, oh, I'm French, here's the French anthem, or from France, and such.
Okay. So at JGMS, students' reflection becomes more formalized. Students reflect on projects through a summative narrative, and in class critiques, they become more formalized as well. The idea of in-process critiques are also brought about where they're introduced, where students look at unfinished work. and make suggestions. And this type of reflection is helpful because as students are not finished with the work, they're more willing to make changes and alterations. The idea of keeping a digital portfolio from grades 6 to 8 is also in the works and something I'm very excited about. Staff and families are able to see the artistic growth across the years, and that's something that would be exciting to continue, I think, into the high school as well.
In our theater arts classes, the students are studying the traditions of storytelling, and in that aspect, they are looking through scripts, they are understanding the characters that they're reading about, they are working on skits and improv to fully develop the characters that they're learning about, and so they're having discussions about how this character that they're being asked to portray is either the same or different from them, what their character might have been feeling in the story, and hopefully it just opens their eyes up a bit to the differences that are out there in our world and how they can be more sensitive to people who might be different from themselves.
Okay. So in eighth grade art, students are required to create a collaborative social justice and commentary project, which is really inspiring. Through research and through research of primary sources and also internet searches as well, students are required to select a topic and then work collaboratively to create either a two or three-dimensional project and then also give a presentation to the school community. So it's really touching on a lot of sort of 21st century skills, talking about working collaboratively with people, problem solving, creativity, and then also presentation skills. The presentation on the left is about acceptance and particularly about the LGBTQ community, and the small hill on the right represents the small-minded mountains, and then the rainbow bridge is the bridge of acceptance, and then the larger sort of world represents education on that topic. And then the one on the right is a little bit more self-explanatory, is the dangers of drug abuse. So they basically do the research on the topics and then present as well. That's it, yeah. And I think the next slide is, this is a student presentation that I captured a couple weeks ago on pollution.
Project on pollution. Here we have the dark side of corporations chopping down the forest to make room for more expansions.
According to the Lakes of America, a conclusion for the Chief of Water Rights and Swim Conflict, that guy can swim, bad idea.
So here are our seniors, our 12th graders, soon to be graduates of Bedford High School, talking about what's important and special to them with music and art.
Music is special to me because it's my favorite way of expressing myself, and I'm also able to connect with others in a really special way.
Music is special to me because it requires a commitment that makes me strive for perfection.
A lot of great creative ideas down here.
art to do.
Continuing in our theme of serving the community, our orchestra students are in the second year of a project where they are doing 5 hours of music-related community service each year as part of their orchestral studies and requirements. So students have opportunities to help with either our middle school concerts or our elementary school concerts, but they also do things like for our morning break at the high school after second block, it's about 15 minutes long, and the students will hear an announcement that there is an orchestra will be performing in the library, and people come and they hear the orchestra perform. And I suspect that the music selection is probably a bit different than what our students have on their iPhones and their iPods. So we love to expand their view on music in that way. And also our orchestra has, that's okay, our orchestra has performed at the Senior Center last year. And so we walked across the field and played for our senior citizens, which was a really nice event. And here's just a clip I like to brag about the orchestra because they play really well, just from competition last year, just a clip on so you can hear how they sound.
So this slide illustrates a few of the projects that are done in ceramics. They're continuing their investigation of cultural awareness and proficiency. The image on the left is an incredibly detailed and realistic sushi platter. Looks real. Getting hungry looking at it. And the image on the right is an interesting project where students are asked to create a jar or a container for an ancestor. So they're researching some of their cultural heritage and creating something that is meaningful to their own personal heritage.
Students in our world drumming class are continuing that explorations into cultural proficiency by learning about different cultures throughout the world that use drumming as part of their local traditions. Typically, the students in these classes are taking it as their requirement for music for graduation. It's not necessarily our performers from band and orchestra and chorus. So they're likely having their first musical ensemble experience as older kids, where they need to listen across the room, work together, play patterns in a prescribed way, but also be communicating with Mr. Felker as he leads the class. Yeah, and if you could, or watching their hands, you can see a variety of different parts going on. So there's a few things that the students have had to learn and interlace their part with other parts that are happening at the same time.
Okay. This is something I'm particularly proud of to be a part of, and that's the Tenacity Challenge. And it offers our Latin and African American students an opportunity to work collaboratively and as a team in several different areas. And one of those areas is the mural component, where they have to voice their ideas through some sort of a visual, either a two-dimensional or three-dimensional. And they're required to verbalize that through an idea that is prescribed to them. So not only do they have to research those ideas and then create it visually, working as a team and deciding who's doing what and who's working on what when, but they also have to defend their ideas and their visual choices to a panel of judges. And we had three teams last year, and they did very well, and can't wait for this year.
Our Our students and our performing ensembles are using their iPads to record their play tests and their sing tests for their assignments. So they are, well, looking at the guidelines that this teacher has set forth for them, but they're also listening back to their own recordings, hopefully reflecting on what they've done, and hopefully, we hope that they're re-recording and making it even better if they had heard mistakes or whatnot in their own recordings. So she has asked their students to watch a video that she's attached the assignment, to sing the scale like she has demonstrated, and to listen to her recording again in their own recording and sort of compare the two and write a short self-reflection. And then on the next slide. On the next slide, the little top box is where the student has uploaded her version of the assignment, and she writes about her own. She says that her recording was definitely different from yours, the teacher's, that it was difficult for her to reach the high do at the end of the solfege. Also, going backwards is harder for me to stay on rhythm almost. I think my recording was different from yours because your voice sounded just overall a lot more neater than mine, which is something I would definitely like to work on in class. So she is a developing singer. She's using some appropriate music terminology and then describing things like how her voice doesn't sound as neat as the teacher's, you know, in her own way. And Ms. Falstick replies to her. She says, the high do may have felt high to you, but it actually sounded great to me. You were going into your head voice on that do, and that's the right thing to do. We'll work on a developing head voice as the year goes on, and I think the neater quality you're talking about is my vowel shape and pronunciation. Your vowels are very spread instead of round, and a lot of sound was resonating in your nose, and we'll be working on all of those things throughout the year. And she says, nice job singing in tune, though. So the student can take this feedback and listen to, you know, listen and reflect upon what she's done. And this is just helping us gain our independent musicians and our students that we're looking for.
Okay. This slide here shows a student-led critique, which is really, it's exciting to see where this is starting at Davis, where they're doing these gallery walks, and they're just looking for some interesting things to talk about, to this, where the students are driving the discussion. The teacher is more of a guide on the side, if you will, and they are basically batting ideas back and forth between each other, and really the teacher is just observing at this point. The ninth grade students, this doesn't happen right at ninth grade. This is sort of a culminating effect, but the ninth grade students really do need the leadership from the teacher at that point. But as the students progress in art in each of the different courses that we offer, they gain more independence and they are able to take more of a leadership role when discussing art and in critiques in general.
Our senior humanities students are working together to piece the different parts that they're learning in class. They're learning from a literature teacher, a visual arts teacher, and a music teacher. And at the end of each unit, we're doing our best to have these collaborative projects in which the students work together to tie everything they've learned in the unit together in some sort of project where they also are creating art. So after reading Dante's Inferno, they were assigned specific cantos to used to inspire their project, their group project, and they took the words that they were assigned. They had to explain the meaning or what's happening in the text to the class, and they also created stained glass windows because we have been studying cathedrals and the architecture behind them and some of the symbolism in the stained glass. And this is done on acetate with markers, which look great in the classroom window when the sun's shining through them. But they describe to the class what they have, you know, the symbolism of their visual choices. And they also take the words that they were assigned and either set it all to music or take important phrases from it and set it to music in the style of Gregorian chant. And then they're either recorded in the safety of their home or they perform it live for the class, whatever their choice was. And the projects, you know, the students have had very good we've gotten great responses from the students saying this was a very helpful project to them to help bring it all together.
Okay, so this slide represents the capstone project for our senior artists, and The image on the right is a senior installation from one of our graduating seniors last year, Carly Martin. And the seniors, the students that are participating in the installation really are completely on their own here. They might ask us for a little bit of feedback and guidance, but they are really curating their own mini exhibit. So not only are they're deciding on what artwork is displayed, they're choosing and making decisions on how it's displayed, and physically attaching these large panels together. So a little bit of minor carpentry involved. And accompanying that is the senior installation artist statement, which when you compare it to our second graders, it really has come a long way. And they're not only talking about the art that's on display, but also talking about their journey as artists and problem solvers and where they intend to go next in their lives with art. If it's not majoring in art, it's including art somehow in their post-high school career.
So what are our future directions, our intentions, our pathways? We were very excited last January when we were able to pull the entire music and entire art department together in this room, actually, for a day of professional development. We invited Dr. Sandy Nicolucci. She's a music emeritus professor from Boston University and had spent her previous career before retiring in the public schools, being a department head of her music department. But she knows the new state frameworks, or the new national frameworks, really, really well. She came in, she helped us dissect them and led us through some activities which helped us to understand them better so we can use them in our teaching as well.
So in closing, I think it was sort of natural for Nicole and I to present together because we had such a tremendous experience with the professional development that we were afforded last year, and that there are a lot of connections and overlap in our departments, not only at the K through 5 level, where they are really the only teachers in the building in that particular content area, and they really rely on each other as islands almost, but really throughout the 6 through 12 as well, we do find quite a lot of overlap, and we're really excited to really investigate some of the authentic ways that we can tie our curriculum together. And I think that's it. And that is finito. If you have any questions at all, we can take those from anyone who has them. Tracy. Right. Tracy, I know you have a lot of questions.
Let me start with Tracy. So yeah. We'll kind of go down the road. Tracy, could you talk a little bit about what you saw here, maybe what they maybe you should know about the art program, your experience?
Well, I've been doing music personally. My sister is really into music, so when I first came here, which was last year, I just felt really like integrated in the music department, like theater, like from the beginning, because I did the play, I did the musical, and like it's just always like I've always done music, and like I took guitar with Mr. Gunnwald, and I just love that. Like art, on the other hand, I've never liked art, but coming here and like working on the mural in Tenacity with Mr. Hagen really has taught me to appreciate art a lot more. We did one third of the mural, by the way, just wanted to put that out there. And my friends are really into art, and so like for me, I know there was a senior talking about like what art means to them, and for me, like art and music just means living, because like it's always around me. Like my sister's always singing, or I'm always singing. My friends are always making films, and I'm always in them, or they're always drawing around me. So it's a great thing, and like I think everybody here loves it, and just.
Awesome. Thank you for saying that.
Thank you, Tracy.
Ms. Santiago.
Thank you very much for your presentation. I don't really have any questions. It's very interesting to see the perspective on how it all comes together, because I see the art projects that my kids bring home, but seeing how it's part of a whole has been very interesting. So thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Mr. Pierce.
Thank you. Sorry to be late. I think, you know, to me, this is, we always say a well-rounded, balanced education. And we say it with the idea that there's a core course of subjects, and then there's these other things over on the side. And it strikes me that, you know, looking at this, there was a slogan, I think it was GE, that had said, essentially, GE brings good things to life, right? And I'm looking at that, and I'm saying, you know, the arts department does have the opportunity to do that through the visual, you know, the 21st century learning skills. I mean, mine was drill and kill and, you know, sage on the stage, not the guide on the side. So it was much more regimented. And I look at what you're doing today and what the schools are doing today, and I say, there is more overlap. You know, I look at it as saying, why couldn't the English department, you talk about the cross-pollination of the visual and performing arts, and I'm going to take it a little further and say, what about the English department? And I'm sorry, I'm looking at you, Mary Lou,
okay.
But you know, if the country songs are now the three verse stories or whatever they are, of you know, breakup, divorce, whatever the thing is, you know, couldn't we take it in an English class and put it with all these iPad stuff and these little apps, put something to music, so a kid creates a verse that becomes music. I couldn't do that, but anyway, those are the things that run through my head of how we can take the stuff on the paper and bring it into the arts and show people that I might not have any talent to sing or dance or any of that kind of stuff, but maybe I can, you know, kind of write a tune or see it come to life. And I go and I look at, you know, the voice example that you had up there. And, you know, talking, I think you said, through her nose and as opposed to the way she's supposed to or whatever it is. And part of the presentation skills is to learn how to speak. And if that's a 21st century skill, that's an opportunity for the arts to really help students in developing their voice. And the independence that you talked about in the senior year, you know, I guess you have the culminating project on one side, and we don't see that as much. You know, you can walk around the school at the end of the year, and you see that the installations are fabulous, and you see that the enthusiasm that these and the story that these kids have, the passion for their project, and I look at that and say, you know, my God, do. Other students in the, you know, the science and, you know, and I don't mean to pick on those aspects of it, but did they have the same passion that the performing or visual arts folks have? And I think it gives them the opportunity, when you say story, to reflect, you know, what they've gone from second grade to and I see this thing, and you know, maybe it's, you know, light dawns on Marblehead, in my case, of how intricate this could be woven more so into the real, you know, curriculum to make it carry through the whole way, as opposed to what my perception has always been, is that the performing arts and the visual arts are kind of over here, and then there's the core courses. So maybe there's hope for me to understand this thing after, you know, so many years, that really kind of putting it together is something that would be, you know, a terrific value to what we do for the 21st century kid. So anyway, I'll get off my soapbox and pass it over.
Thank you, sir. Ann?
I just found it fascinating and very thorough, and I'm embarrassed. I don't always think of how arts and music, how the two relate, and it was wonderful to put it together like this. And thank you for starting with kindergarten and taking it to the end. It made it, we could sort of see the, as it built and what it did. And they're not teaching art and music like I learned it, and students are quite fortunate to have it. Things I really, really enjoyed, I keep thinking about those gallery walks. Now there's some kids here that go to the MFA three times a year. They start going when they're little kids, and there are other students that may not. And yet you're creating opportunities for all of them to see that their opinions matter. And then the nice, How often do you get to ask kids, what do you do well and what do you need to work on? I know we do it in other courses, but not necessarily in art or music. And they can take this all with them. And even getting those boys to do the Lane body percussion, that took some work. And they obviously put a lot of thought and planning into it. And yet they really seemed, they didn't seem inhibited, and that's what I liked about this. Nobody seemed particularly inhibited or worried that they didn't necessarily have this innate talent. They did it. And the self-reflection. And just to see second graders with seniors, we wish it happened more. And then on a Saturday, wow, kudos to that. And yeah, just sort of for everyone to do that, and I bet they really got a lot out of it. And then the crossover, I was fascinated by the crossover of social studies into art, to sort of take that idea and bring it through. And then they all seemed to enjoy the guided discussion work. And how often, you know, think back to when I'm a little bit older, nobody really cared what I thought about how I was taught to sing or draw. And so it's interesting to sort of see how today they asked them, and they all wanted to give their opinions, and they all wanted to comment. And you know, if I remember one thing from tonight, it'll be the idea that the orchestral studies students are playing in the hall. That's pretty neat and pretty good. And finally, the improv and the skit work. It's just, there's so much there, the collaborative, the community projects, the creating and the presenting it, and it's just wonderful to see how you've woven the arts through K-12, so thank you. I found it riveting.
So I'll just read through my comments.
It's like 15 minutes. No.
I really like the presentation, first of all, just because it really does show the arc from K-12. And what I like most isn't just sort of the time lapse, although that's interesting, it's that there are things that are consistent in every level, right? The gallery walks, the self-reflection. I just like that in that K-12 arc, there's just some threads that are pulled all the way through. And it came through in the presentation, but also it comes through and just now I have a better sense of, you know, kind of the work kids are doing. When I grew up, there was, maybe not directly, but there was definitely a message that you can choose music or you can choose sports. And I'm so happy that that's no longer a choice, that you can do both. And you know, I had this thing with my son. He does chorus, band, and orchestra, and singing, and all this stuff. And he was like, "Yeah, I don't get recess anymore." And then, so we had this conversation about, like, it's really bigger than recess, right? It's about, you know, exposing yourself to this. And a couple weeks later, I said, "Like, how's the recess thing going?" He said, "Of course, it's great." You know, and so that's the point, right? Is that he didn't have to make a choice, or that he was given this opportunity that he wouldn't have otherwise. He wanted recess because it was comfortable. And then he explored something else and he realized he actually maybe liked it a little bit more than that. And he gets up early. I mean, there's a lot of early things over at that Lane school. It's like 3-4 times a week. It's amazing. But he gets out because of the work your teachers do. And he gets out because it's mostly important. So please pass it on to them. I wish I could see other presentations that have that similar arc, just for whatever it's worth. I think it's helpful for us. A couple comments I had along the way were, I love the student comment that says it gives me a chance to think other ways. That's like the very soul of what you're asking kids to do, think in other ways. And there's just such clear vertical alignment here. It's just so carefully constructed. And I just wrote, it's yet more evidence why our kids are so lucky to be in Bedford. Because I don't think this is every child's experience. Now, it probably should be, but I don't think every child's doing this. And I think it's worth noting that the Bedford kids are so uniquely lucky. I've been hearing about digital portfolios for years, and I would just love to see it happen. I mean, I remember hearing about it like 20 years ago, and even as a teacher, like, hey, we're going to do digital portfolios. It sort of never happened. But you two are in a unique position as sort of administrator directors who see that whole thing, to be able to carry that for them. So I would love to see that happen. And the last comment I had was...
Making that happen now.
So, yeah.
Now we're on the open media.
Yeah, exactly. It's just, so to watch, to go from body percussion to that orchestral piece, I just wrote, from body percussion to this, wow. And it just kind of really shows how much growth these kids are making and just how lucky they are. So thank you for doing what you do. And please pass along our appreciation to your teachers, because they are really doing exceptional things and giving these kids exceptional opportunities. And we, as a community, and certainly as a committee, we appreciate it.
Yeah, great job. A couple of thoughts. One is, I just think it's an interesting. around some very common things, metacognition, reflection, and that you're finding a balance between developing that in kids, but also giving them the freedom to express themselves, have fun, and explore. And that's a little bit of a challenging balance to pay attention to, but I think, you know, we're really on the right track with that. I think that there are other, as Sean said in the beginning, this is just a snapshot. So there's a whole realm in which technology is being used for artistic expression. Kids are making films, other things like that which relate to this. And maybe we'll pull that in next time. But to that point, can you speak a little bit about some of the thinking about what we're calling STEAM?
Sure, absolutely. We are in sort of the beginning talks with Donna Clements and specifically some of our JGMS teachers, Paul Harrington and Candy Banks, and some other teachers at JGMS about creating some maker spaces, or we have another term we're throwing around is innovation spaces, where it's not just the end product is that you make something, but it's the trial and error, which is really valued, not so much the product that comes out of it. It's more about process-oriented work. And it's really exciting. We've met a few times, but we really want to come up with a tangible set of plans to move forward, not just, okay, we'll meet again in 2 months, but to really, I'm sorry, build up steam. I think what we want to see happen is eventually with the building that's going to happen in a few years, hopefully at JGMS, additional classroom space, is to allocate one of those rooms perhaps for a space to have one of these innovation labs, and where students can go and they can have, you know, a group of students that they're working together with to create some product, or just to go through a set of challenges to get them to think about ways of integrating science, technology, engineering, art, and math, or design and math.
Sean and I had been talking with Sarah Dorr, and she was talking about vocabulary that they use in math. And I said, well, we can use those words too, and when we're talking about our subject matters. So we've sort of preliminarily started a vocabulary list of ways that we can use the same words at the same years that the students are learning them, so that they can more fully understand the vocabulary.
Right. Thank you for all your hard work. Please pass a really sincere appreciation on to all your art and music teachers.
Will do.
They really, the work that they do is hugely valued, so thank you. All right, on to far more exciting things like budgets.
Budget overview. So, in the year, I try to do just a forecasting that comes out of the view of what we're looking at this point, the possibilities and kind of as starting from David, as he always does, like an amazing job, kind of pulling all of our numbers together. Coming to the how many line items? 448 line items to be able to make a projection based on where we are and you know, where we're going to be as a starting point for FY18. That includes kind of having to look at every single teacher and check whether that teacher is changing lanes because of their increased professional development, steps, changes in the special ed budget coming and going, and as you know, as we've talked about already this year, you know, just another child moving into our district can change our budget by $70,000, $80,000, $90,000. So with that said, we are projecting a maintenance of effort baseline, which is how we started last year. Maintenance effort means basically kind of no additions, no changes in program, no changes in additional staff, but where we would be in order to simply maintain services as they presently exist. of a 2.894% increase. 2.894. We are presently, the FY17 approved budget is $37,710,703. This would be an increase of $1.91 million for a total of 1.091. And specifically, $1,091,416. For a total maintenance of effort budget of $38,802,119. So again, that's kind of moving all of our staff forward. It's with a placeholder similar to this year's COLA of 2%. We are entering negotiations and bargaining will begin actually in January. We've had a preliminary meeting with the association. So those are, that's a factor that we can't absolutely predict at this point. But I think that's a good start. We anticipate some needs, again, based on continued growth coming up through Davis School, now hitting the Lane School. We know that we're going to need to add at least one classroom teacher at Lane. We know that the SAIL program will be transitioning to Lane, our program for children with autism. And so that will necessitate the addition of teaching staff and teaching assistant staff, outfitting a room, et cetera. We also, as you could see when I presented the class size report, we are really kind of coming apart at the seams in our arts and wellness courses at John Jay Middle School. Where classes are 28, 29, 30 consistently. In those classes, which is not, doesn't serve our children well. So we're looking at some expansion there of some additional wellness and art teachers in particular. So those are kind of the broad strokes of the possible additions we'll be looking at. These figures don't include any significant jumps in technology or new textbooks. We're still gathering that data. We don't expect anything out of the ordinary compared to this year, but we're still in that process. David, is there anything?
No, we're still, it's still early. Our special ed stuff is still sort of being solidified, especially with the success we've had in bringing kids back and not sending kids out. You know, the case numbers are holding steady. Same with lab. You know, we're shrinking that population, but I think we're going to get to a point in time where that's just, you know, it is what it is. The science community that we are getting back from the sort of higher end of the percentage rates down to something that is pretty standard and usual. But we still have a long way to go with that stuff. A lot of some unknown, but I think we're in pretty good shape right now.
And the, sorry, just the, you know, the offset to that. So we're down to approximately 60 students.
Something in the neighborhood of 60.
You know, if you remember, we were up at 130, usually at one point. So huge positive impact on our budget, but with some needs to accommodate many of those kids in district, and therefore some additional staffing at the preschool that we talked about at the last meeting, and of course for the SAIL program.
So thank you for this. It's helpful to just have that 10,000-foot view. I think we'll give something similar to FinCom when we present to them on December 1st. I guess I like the phrase maintenance of effort because the way I think about it is if we just roll everything forward, if we were to buy everything next year that we have this year, what would it cost? In other words, you know, if you were to buy the same amount of groceries on January 1st, 2015 and January 1st, 2016, exact same groceries, it's going to cost you a certain amount over, but you're getting the exact same product. And that phrase, maintenance of effort, I think it's a good phrase. So it helps me sort of picture that. The other piece of it, I guess, is that we are always looking at out-of-district costs. And it's worth noting that those are fluid at some point. We feel like, I guess the point is this is a snapshot at top, and this is where we think it is. But those things could change in an instant, whether it's a child moving out, child moving in, whether it's tuition changing. One of the things I would appreciate is that when you recoup out-of-district costs, you also don't have to expend those transportation costs. So it always feels like a two-for-one. You know, when we bring a child back in district, we're then not transporting them as far to other communities as well. So that always feels good. But any questions? Tracy? Joanne?
No.
Ed?
Thank you.
Just a question, John. In looking at your chart, in your 2.9, the regular education, the needs that you outlined, what range are you looking at in terms of these are all additions, right?
Potential additions.
Like what range, if you were to do all of them, what do you think it would be?
Can we move on to something else?
Sure.
Give your minutes to do that based on what we normally project. And again, this is going to be a really rough estimate.
Yeah,
some of these people are actual people, so they have a set kind of salary. Others are based on our normal standard of an M4 to an M6. So they will give a rough estimate.
Yeah, because what I was looking at is if I figure that 0.25% increase or but a quarter of an increase is about $94,000. I'm just trying to see how far some of this might go. Now, granted, the SPED is accounting for about $175,000 as a decrease. So it's kind of the regular ed is going up greater than 2.9, but just kind of trying to get an idea of what we'd be looking at. And the special ed, we have the line special ed Davis and Lane 3 to 6 teaching assistants. Is that all this on the back page, or is that?
No. That is for the sale program.
That's
the
just
a. Is all about the preschool.
It's all about the preschool? Okay.
So, we know that the net for the additional class of preschool, including if we bring some existing staff who are paid for by grant or by tuition, we bring them into the budget.
Yes.
Something that may get negotiated this year. The net salary impact is $55,008, and then there's a benefit impact. So we'll add that to some estimates around these FTE, and I'll give you a figure.
Yeah. Okay.
I guess I would just prefer to maybe just hold on to the next time they actually give those numbers rather than spitball on a sort of quick
question. But
I think Ed's point is right. It would be great to look at those regular education. What is the price tag on those? Not price tag, it's crap for a second. But what's the cost on those? And then also preschool, like what are the scenarios? What's the number we're looking at? How do we calculate the percentages? I guess I just feel comfortable doing it next week.
I'm just looking for some ranges, and I understand there are people who are going to hold you to them. I deal with this stuff all the time, and it's just kind of get some idea of what you're thinking, and especially some of this could all change because you're still it's very fluid, and it will continue. I mean, how we're doing it. We're approving things now that weren't in the budget because the needs and circumstances changed. So,
so we'll do that for the next time, right? Because this hasn't really been decided what pieces of this I am actually going to advocate for. But even if that's not the case, I can say here's the outside.
Okay. Ed, anything else?
No, that's it.
Ed?
No, it's Thanksgiving's coming and so it's budget.
Excellent. Thank you for that. Next item on our agenda is the superintendent's report.
So, just in terms of budget, something that I think we're sharing, I don't have to, but as you know, I sit on the board for EDCO, the board for Case Lab, and the board for Lab, and cost of our assessments.
by about half. We're not talking about tuitions now. We're talking about an assessment, which is in the $22,000 range. But that's the result of really, really proactive management for EDCO Collaborative, which is making it possible for us to reduce the assessment that each district pays to keep that program functioning. Last week, a number of things of interest happened. First of all, on Veterans Day, the day before Veterans Day, for the I think third annual Lane Veterans Day commemoration. Very special. Principal Ackerman and his staff create a wonderful experience for kids where veterans from the community, service people, the National Guard, people who will serve on our staff are brought in. Kids bring in their grandparents, parents, and honor our veterans. And the kids really learn about the importance of acknowledging the service that our service people give. Just, it's a great event. Of course, Tuesday, the election, the reverberations of that were felt across the district. Regardless of whether people were happy or unhappy with the results, it was such an intensely felt election and so public an election that we found that our kids from the elementary school up through the high school were highly, highly attuned to what was going on. And so we had kids who were very happy, and we had kids who were very, very upset. And our staff had to manage that when some of them themselves were feeling a range of emotions, depending on where they stood on the election. I think they, by and large, did a really good job. There was outreach to parents because it was, a very powerful experience for everybody.
Can I just add to that?
Yes.
It's worth pointing out that education is really the only field you ever are not allowed to comment on anything. You're not allowed to express any personal opinion when you're addressing other people's personal opinions about the election. And it really is a tremendously hard balance. And for teachers to feel the way they were feeling, positive or negative, and have to deal with positive and negative feelings without ever giving away their own personal political leaning, I just think it's such a dance, and it makes that process so much more difficult. There's no other profession that requires that level of privacy. And so I would just give extra credit to those teachers that really tried to take that on without personalizing it and without getting personally, political.
I think that's really true. I'm teaching a course at BU to graduate students at the moment, and I commented the other day what a difference it is in that environment. Because you can, whatever your feelings are, you can share them. These are college students or graduate students. Most of them are teachers actually coming back to school, as opposed to that very, very difficult dance that we entrust our teachers with, which is to help kids develop their own thinking and not to impose on it. There are two other things I'll just briefly share with you. As you know, one of our goals for this year as part of our equity and goal for the district is to improve our diversity in hiring to be more effective in hiring and supporting and sustaining a more racially diverse staff. And so we have our EDC, our Equity and Diversity Committee, which is our cross-district committee, reached out to the whole district to invite anybody else who was interested in participating in helping us with that work. And we had our first meeting around that today, and we had a number of new teachers that are not new to teaching necessarily, but teachers who had not participated in the EDC before. And just really inspiring conversation and planning for how to be more intentional and more deliberate and systematic about this, including a campaign of reaching out to graduate schools to create a pipeline where we take more students as student teachers, which Bedford's done very little of, and we have so much to offer them,
and in the process increase the number of student teachers of color, who then are more likely to be the teachers that get hired because relationships are built. And so it's just one of many. We're going to actually have an event where we bring people from the universities to Bedford to meet with kids, meet with teachers, and realize that Bedford is not the community many people think the name suggests.
Do we go to hiring fairs at the schools? Because someone asked me that.
We do. We fell off from that for a few years because we just didn't find there was a lot of opportunity there, but also because we hadn't figured out a way to sell Bedford as a place that is not as homogeneous as many people assume. So actually, one of the projects we're doing with Mr. Hagen and some students at the high school is we're creating a video about the Bedford school system. And we plan to use that in this process and in other processes to help to more accurately portray what a unique place we are.
Okay.
So exciting work there. And finally, you know, as you could tell from Assistant Superintendent Salee's presentation around PARC and MCAS, one of the areas that we're working on involves writing, particularly as it was expressed in our Lane School scores and in our JGMS scores. And we have really turned our leadership team meetings for the last month or two towards kind of a deep analysis of data and the kind of programmatic work that's being done or that needs to be improved upon. I look forward to reporting out to you what that work looks like in the future. So.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. All right, next item on our agenda is the approval of minutes. So do I have a motion to approve the Bedford School Committee minutes of November 1st, 2016?
So moved. Amended.
Ann moves. Anyone second?
Sure.
Ed seconds. Joanne, any corrections?
Yes, on line 34, I think it should be IMM.
Immersion, sorry. I'm on page one. On page two, on line 38, there, I don't know about adding, the building committee considered this feedback and ultimately agreed not to widen the road to the school at this time, to add the words at this time, because we did discuss that as a potential option in the future. On page five, line 18, the second word one, I think is extraneous, or there's a word missing. Those are all the changes that I have.
Mr. Pierce, any corrections?
Sure. On page one, line 42, we were talking about the sale program. This position will be funded from surplus funds. I'm not sure that that's what you meant. I think it was more from the I'm not sure how to use the word surplus.
Savings from
in district, yeah, or out of district savings.
Savings from out of district.
Savings from out of district tuitions.
Anything else?
Yeah, on page three, line 44, Mr. Sills also adjusted the cost of the wheelchair lift for the press box to, I think it was $32,000, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Page four, no. Oh, on line, page four, line 31, I think that's grade six is larger than expected. And that's it.
I didn't have any changes.
None for me either. So all in favor say aye.
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 All opposed say no. That one is approved 400. Any future agenda items, Joanne? Ed? Ann?
Not at this time.
Tracy?
All right, Tracy, I told you I'd get you out of here before 9 o'clock.
Nice work.
5 minutes to go. With that, I will accept the motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Anyone moves? Anyone second? You'll second. All in favor? We'll do a roll call vote. Joanne? Yes. Ed?
Yes.
Ann?
Yes.
And I am a yes. With that, we are out of session. Thank you, Bedford, and good night.
Good night.